Warning, some of what is shown here is dangerous to you and your equipment. We accept no liability if you try this yourself. NMR spectroscopy. The technique that brought you chemical shift, scalar coupling, nuclear relaxation, and diffusion proudly presents magnetic susceptibility. The magnetic susceptibility of a material determines whether it will be attracted or repelled by a magnet. Diamagnetic materials are weakly repelled, while paramagnetic materials are weakly attracted to a magnet. All NMR solvents are diamagnetic. We generally use deuterated solvents that have their hydrogens exchanged for the heavier deuterium, so that the solvent signal will not interfere with the NMR spectrum. Here we take deuterium oxide or heavy water and put it in our little boat on a liquid surface. Deuterium oxide has no unpaired electrons, so it's diamagnetic. It is repelled very slowly by a strong magnet. The effect is very weak and it takes a few seconds for the movement to become apparent. Putting the magnet on the other side slows down, stops, and reverses the movement. In the past, before the invention of two-dimensional NMR, for the purposes of spectral assignment, we used to add paramagnetic compounds that bind with parts of the molecule under study, decreasing the dispersion of the signals, aiding assignment. These compounds are called NMR shift reagents. This one is called europium-FOD3, and it is deuterated in order to prevent interference with the proton NMR spectrum. We took this paramagnetic material and put it in our boat. It is slightly attracted to a strong magnet. If we put the magnet on the other side, it slows down, stops, and starts moving in the opposite direction. If the magnet again changes sides, the sampler slowly changes direction. Diamagnetism and paramagnetism are very weak compared to ferromagnetic materials. If we fill our boat with iron filings and put it on the water, the attraction is much, much, much stronger, and the boat flies onto the magnet. So, you may ask, how does magnetic susceptibility affect NMR spectroscopy? Well, NMR chemical shift is measured as the difference in shift between two peaks in the same sample. This is all very well when comparing signals in the same sample, but what happens when you want to compare signals in different samples? Take, for example, TMS in acetone D6 compared with TMS in deuterochloroform. Its chemical shift in acetone D6 is -0.16 ppm, but if you exchange the samples, you will find that the observed shift is 1.12 ppm. The difference between observed and chemical shift is due to differences in bulk magnetization between the solvents due to their different magnetic susceptibilities. The bulk magnetization shift appears under the usual configuration using a vertically aligned sample tube. The shift disappears if the sample is put in a magic angle spinning probe, set to the magic angle, and spun. The bulk magnetization shift is measured by comparing the observed shift at the vertical angle with that at the magic angle. The bulk magnetization shift depends on the bulk magnetization of the sample and its shape factor. By determining the precise shape of the sample and the shape of the excitation profile of the probe, one can use the NMR spectra to calculate the relative bulk magnetization of the sample. This was first tried as far back as 1957, but the results were inaccurate. Only now, with a better model for determining the shape factor, can NMR rival the GUI or Evans balance and superconducting susceptometers. The shape of the meniscus at the top of the sample affects the shape factor significantly. A horizontal line model is not sufficient. A spherical cap fits the meniscus better. However, for a good fit, we need to use the Young Laplace model shown here for chloroform. The response curve for the probe is measured from the line shape arising from the gradient echo. The sample is compared with a gaseous sample with low bulk magnetization to obtain the absolute bulk magnetization. Oxygen in the air is paramagnetic, and as it dissolves in solvents, it changes their magnetic susceptibility. Here we have the susceptibility of deuterochloroform as a function of temperature and partial oxygen pressure. With accurate magnetic susceptibility values, one can adjust the observed shifts measured in vertical samples to give their chemical shifts. The chemical shift of an inert monatomic gas at low pressure is theoretically independent of temperature. Here we use the comparison of frequencies of the proton signal of tetramethylsilane in deuterochloroform and helium-3 signal of helium-3 gas to redetermine the effect of temperature on the chemical shift of the tetramethylsilane standard. The chemical shift is found to decrease by 0.0006 ppm per degree. It is now possible to measure magnetic susceptibility accurately by NMR spectroscopy. This opens up new possibilities for evaluating the degree of bond ionization in diamagnetic materials. One can use accurate measurements of magnetic susceptibility to correct for bulk susceptibility shifts and compare chemical shifts in different solvents or in complex fluids such as microemulsions. Every time a new parameter can be measured, it opens up a new window of opportunities. Our NMR lab will provide this new, exciting and exclusive technique as part of its service. If you want to stay updated, please subscribe, get the bell on, press the like button, and order NMR services at the link and in the description below.